That's the one too.
Thank you.
Simple Truths Ministry broadcasting Sunday evening, 8 o'clock, every Sunday evening. We try to anyway. Just like to say Happy Mother's Day to one and all. All you mothers out there, soon to be mothers and prospective mothers, wishing you a happy Mother's Day, hoping your day has been filled with joy and rejoicing. Just like to play this short mini video on Mother's Day.
Today is Mother's Day, and we want to acknowledge all the women we're blessed to know. We rejoice over you for your strength, your wisdom, your strong love, and your beautiful faith. Whether today is a celebration for you or a day of quiet reflection and healing, we're thinking of all of you. If you gave birth this year to your first child, our joy overflows and we celebrate with you. If you adopted a child this year or became a foster parent, we rejoice with you, and we want to honor you in your commitment to changing the lives of children. If you continue to struggle with infertility, we are hoping with you and holding your hand in prayer. If you are exhausted and feeling underappreciated for all you do for a house full of kids, we applaud you. We love you. And we appreciate you more than you can ever imagine. And if you lost a child this year to death or miscarriage, we weep and mourn with you. And if your child is lost to addiction or to the world, we hurt with you. And we join you in putting our hope in the one who brings prodigals home. If you live with painful memories of your mom, we pray that you will find in a spiritual mother all that you never had from a birth mom. And if you're one of those amazing spiritual moms, we thank you for stepping up and being there when others couldn't. If you're experiencing an empty nest for the first time this year, we walk with you in this new season and are excited about the next chapter God has planned for you. If you're single, we celebrate your strength, beauty, and individuality, and join with you in praying for the desires of your heart. If you're a single mom and wonder if you have the physical energy and financial resources to raise and provide for your child or children, we want to help you, and we will. And if you're pregnant for the first time, we prayerfully anticipate with you the joyful birth of a healthy child. And to all the special women on this Mother's Day, rest and delight in knowing that we are thankful for you, and we celebrate each and every one of you.
Amen. We enjoyed you, everyone signing on this evening. Thank you, Facebook Live, for being with us, Zoom. We're so happy to be here this evening on this Mother's Day to celebrate mothers everywhere. We're going to start off with a little celebration coming from Leandra Johnson. We did this last week, and it just touched my soul and my spirit way down in my yana now, so I just wanted to do it again one more time.
He leads me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. When you become a believer, your spirit is made right, but sometimes the soul doesn't get the notice. It has a hole in it due to things that's happened in the past, hurt, abuse, molestation. But we want to speak to you today and tell you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. Some people's actions are not because their spirit is wrong, but it's because the past has left a hole in their soul. May this wisdom help you get over your past and remind you that God wants to heal the hole in your soul. I have my sister, Leandria, here. She's going to help me share this wisdom and tell this story.
God wants to heal the hole.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me.
myself from my overthinking.
Yes.
If you're listening out there, just repeat after me if you're struggling with your past and say, oh, oh. Let the Lord know. Just say, oh. Oh, oh, oh. He wants to restore your soul. Just say, hey, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven. Break it on down. So it is. It is so. Amen. When we pray, we want to end that with a declaration, a decree. So I'm speaking for all of you listening, starting here, starting now. The things that hurt you in the past won't control your future. Starting now, this is a new day. This is your exodus. You are officially released. Now sing it for me, Leandria.
Thank you, Lord, for coming out of my troubles. Hallelujah. Our announcements for today. We're so glad this week we got to celebrate National Prayer Day. Now we have coming up still Peace Officers Memorial Day and Memorial Day. Every Sunday evenings, 8 p.m., we celebrate with Family Bible Study. There's the link. Join us. Come on board and enjoy yourselves as we study the Bible together and get challenged through different questions about the Bible. Our assignment coming up for May 15th, we're going to be journaling here ages 20 through 40 for next Sunday. And doing our SWOT analysis, strengths and weaknesses, we'll be looking at that so that we can discover how we stand before God, our strengths and our weaknesses. For tonight, we're going to go ahead and do parts of the marriage and family vision. And Proverbs challenge. We're in day number 8, going into number 9. I've been making, I'm sorry? Oh, vision. I put two S's in vision, huh? It goes to show you what my vision is. Oh, I put an L instead of an I? Religion. Proverbs challenge. We're in day number 9. We're going on day number 9. We finished day number 8 today. You can go ahead and make your post still. And on day number 9, we'll start all over again. Posting your thoughts, your concerns, your questions, whatever you feel. You can follow the link there, become a member, and join in on the challenge. 31 days in the month of May, 31 chapters in the book of Proverbs, and we read a chapter a day and we post our thoughts and insights. Anything that stands out to you that you may have a concern with, come on and join us. Celebrations for the month of May. We're so glad to celebrate. Now, this had to be a setup. We celebrated Jeanette for her anniversary. We celebrated her, followed with her birthday the next week, and then the same week we celebrated Mother's Day. Come on here, somebody, for the celebrations. We also have Shantia Clyburn listed down. We're so happy for you all, ladies, and all the mothers out there, potential mothers, women all over the world. We're so glad to say Happy Mother's Day to you and to celebrate this day with you. Birthdays, anniversaries, life events, we celebrate with you yours and hope you can rejoice in them and be glad. We're going to ask Miss Chloe if she would give us our devotional prayer, the local prayer for the sick and the shut-in. And we're going to ask Minister Deanne Couch if she would give us our national and global prayer.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Father God, thank you for waking us up this morning, Lord. Thank you for the ability to move around, Father God. Thank you that we can do the things that we take for granted, like moving our toes and our fingers and breathing on our own, Lord. We pray, Father God, for those who have waken up in the hospital, waking up in positions that they can't do these things on their own, Lord. May you please watch over them, be with them, Lord. Those who are scared, Father God, we're asking that you cover them, Lord. Those who are bounded by the bed and have physicians attending them, Father God, may you please be with those providers and those nurses and anybody that's attending them. Lord, we pray, Lord, for the sick and the poor, Father God, those who are outside, Father God, in this hot weather in some places like Texas, Father God, and they have nowhere to go, Lord. Jesus. Or even just any weather that's uncomfortable, Father God. Those, Father God, who are sick on the streets, Lord, and have nowhere to go, Father God. Those who are not even in their right mind, Lord. We lift them all up to you, Father God. And we know, Lord, that with you, Lord, anything is possible, Lord. We know, Father God, that any healing, Lord, can be done by you, Father God. Even when the doctors, Father God, say there's nothing else that could be done, Lord, you have the final word, Lord.
Yes.
So, Father God, Lord, we are looking up to you, Lord, to be our miracle, Father God, to give us new hope, Father God, in those circumstances, Father God, that we don't have hope, whether it's those who are sick, those who are just facing situations, Father God, that they don't have any hope, Lord, we're turning to you, Father God. And Lord, if we don't wake up tomorrow, Father God, we just pray, Lord, that we'll be by your side, Lord.
Yes, God.
So please, Lord, just watch over us, Father God. Watch over our family, watch over our friends, and all of our loved ones, Father God. We love you. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Chloe, Amen. Welcome back. How have you been?
I've been good.
Are you going to be on duty June the 5th?
I have to check. I can text you to tell you. I'm trying to see really quick without holding anybody up. It looks like I will be.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I forgot the app was supposed to be praying. You say it looks like you'll be off duty?
No, I'll be on duty.
You'll be on duty. Okay.
Yes. Go ahead. Okay,
I'm sorry. I jumped the gun.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come before your throne of grace. Let us sit still and turn every problem and situation we have going on in our hearts and minds and to come together in unity in this prayer through Zoom and Facebook, fan and family of Simple Ministries, Simple Truth Ministries. Father, there is so much rampant evil that is running throughout this world right now. We know that you are a God that sits high and looks low. We come together and we pray that there be other prayer warriors that are Christian. Forget the denominations, that's man stuff. But we come together and we call upon your name. And we ask you to come down into this yes. realm, send in your angels, Lord, send in help, because this is truly a wicked, wicked world. And it's very, very, you're watching the television and you're listening And you listen to wars and rumors of wars, God, and people getting nervous and upset and taking their focus off of you. We ask you right now, God, to send godly people to our national and local leaders, people that pray. Speak to those people, to speak to our local and national representatives of us, God, so they have our best interest. We pray that your will be done, that your kingdom come on this earth. And we thank you right now for the blessings that we have. We thank you for another Mother's Day, but we ask you to be with those that are grieving. Be with those that have gone through disaster. Be with those that are going through the outcome of this COVID and how it just strips so many people of their jobs and their livelihoods and their homes, God. We ask that there be restoration in this land, Lord, as well as other lands, Lord. We pray for those that continue to research this disease, that they come together and they get us all on one accord and heal the land in which you have given us. We thank you right now ahead of time. We praise you, we bless you, and give you the glory and honor. Thank you, God, for seeing another Mother's Day. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, God. Amen. Hallelujah. Chloe, I need you to give me the first two available Sundays that you're going to be free in the month of June or July.
Okay.
Okay. Miss Shari, how are you this evening, Shari? If you're speaking, you're muted, Shari.
Is she welcome? Hi, everyone. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to you also. Listen, are you available June the 5th?
Yes.
You're going to be here June the 5th?
Be here, June 5th.
I mean, online with us.
Yes.
Okay, I want you to bring the Bible study on June the 5th. Prepare a 30-minute lesson on the topic of your choosing and get with my wife so she can help you through it, okay?
Hold on. Huh?
June the 5th, you're going to bring the Bible study of the Bible study lesson and get with my wife so she can help you through it. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome. Happy.
How what? Oh, okay. All right. Thank you, ladies. Let me see. Where do we go from here?
I'm sorry. I got cut off earlier. I was saying happy Mother's Day to Miss Jeanette and Miss Deanne.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Same to you.
And the same to you, Miss Mother. All you ladies, potential mothers, all mothers. God bless you and keep you is my prayer. And I hope that Mother's Day was filled with rejoicing, prosperity, health, and happiness for you, and that you got a chance to just shine. Amen. On Mother's Day. You know, my mother passed away, but God has blessed me on Mother's Day to have women in my life that really revere and respect me and hold me as their son these days. And I'm grateful for that. You know, I'm grateful it makes Mother's Day a little bit more bearable. It used to be Mother's Day was one of the worst days for me just because my mother was no longer here. But Mother's Day is all right these days now. It's bearable again. So for those of you who don't have a mother, I share with you that pain of the loss. And I also pray that some woman in your life shows that shining example to you that these women have to me and mine. God bless and keep you. Is my prayer. Tonight we're going to have the Bible challenge. What is real fellowship with God? But before that, we're going to get some snippets of marriage family vision that we had put together. We're going to share those snippets on this Sunday and next Sunday. And the assignment for next Sunday is not only the marriage family vision snippets, but complete our journaling up to age 40. Now, I know some of you may not be 40 yet. Amen. But I'm sure you're getting close to the 25 or the 36 range. So just go as high as you are if you can't go up to 40 or beyond. And we also want to be ready for next week to have our strengths and our weaknesses. What do you think your strengths and your weaknesses are when it comes to the Christ and the gospel. What are your strengths? Well, when it comes to life, period, what do you think your strengths and your weaknesses are? Our poll tonight, when I consider my relationship with God, I wonder at times if it is real fellowship. Real fellowship is a real term. And real fellowship indicates that we have something that is unique, significant, that we fellowship with. The fellowship I have with God is real. I have no doubt about it, is number one on the poll. The fellowship I have with God is real. However, I think I could do better at it, number two on the poll. Number three, I'm not sure how real the fellowship is I have with God, but I am still working at it. Number four, I don't know what it means to have fellowship with God. I don't know something, I do know something greater than myself created me and the world that I live in. So where do you fit in? I fit in number two. I have fellowship with God and it's real. However, I think at times that it could be better. You know, as much as I like to think that I'm holy and I'm good and I'm righteous, there are times where I get to thinking, you could be doing a whole lot better at what you do with the Lord. You could be doing a whole lot better at the relationship you have. You could be doing a whole lot. You say, I can get up in the morning and get moving around and think about the day. I get ahead of myself. I think about all I have to do in the day, and I get up running around, and oops, I done forgot to pray. I done forgot to read. Half the day's gone by, and I'm still sitting there wondering why things aren't working out well for me today, because you left God far behind you this morning. Amen? So sometimes I know I have a good fellowship with God and I know he's with me and I know it's real, but I could be doing better. How about you? Where do you fit in on the fellowship? Amen. We have some, yes, I agree with you there, ladies. Chloe and Deanne, two and a one. Congratulations, we have a one in the midst. Amen. She changed it to two. Okay. Amen. No problem with that. I feel the same way. I could be doing better. Some days I just get going and I forget the word. I forget the prayer and I get rushing and moving and I wonder why I'm having such a calamity that day. Amen. But I could be doing better. And so that was also part of my, well, you'll get that next week. Part of my family vision was that I need to get up in the morning and I need to commit to prayer with my wife and I need to commit to scripture reading with my wife as well as with myself. Here's a short snippet. We're going to cover maybe 10 minutes of the first part of our family, marriage and family vision. This is day one.
This is Jeff Clyburn, Elder Jeff Clyburn, and missionary Jeanette Johnson. And we are in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, where we are broadcasting our yearly vision for our marriage retreat. We're here from the 23rd to the 26th. We're going to spend today for about an hour session going over phase one and phase two, and tomorrow going over phase three and phase four. So for today, the preparation is moving forward together. Moving forward together, in Micah 4 and 2, it says, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord. He will teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. So it's an invitation to go up to the mountain of the Lord, or to go to some place that you can be alone with the Lord so that you can learn his ways. And the ways we're learning in this event are his precepts, his plans, and his future for our marriage. And also in Proverbs 29 and 28, as soon as I get there, Proverbs 29 and 28, the word of the Lord, I'm sorry, 29 and 18, the word of the Lord says, where there is no vision, the people perish, but he that keepeth the law, happy is he. So we're here to establish that vision for our marriage so that we can be in God's precepts and in his will, and we can be happy because the word says so. Amen. Amen. Where are we headed? Where there is no vision, the people perish. With a goal before them, a group of people could set their focus and move together in the right direction. So that's why we're here, to set our focus, move in the right direction, have a goal and a plan of action that we sat down and prepared for ourselves so that we can move on one accord to that goal. The preparation is, first of all, to pray. Pray as a couple and as individuals for clear eyes and soft hearts, surrender and revelation of improvement for the relationship. So please join us now in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, eternal and all-wise God, we thank you, dear Lord, for another year you've given us. We're entering into our seventh year of anniversary of marriage together. We take this year very seriously. We realize you've blessed us in this marriage, and we want you to continue to do so. So we devote this time to you to find out what is the plan that you would have for our marriage. And help us, dear God, to walk in that plan, in your will, in your way, and that the vision might be made plain before us so that we can set the goal and walk together towards it. Amen. I'm going to ask our wife to go ahead and pray, and pray as she will. Amen.
Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for allowing us to walk into the seventh year, God. Lord, we know that the journey has not always been easy, but God, we thank you that you have always been the head and you have helped us to be able to unite with one another from day to day, no matter what the situations may hold. God, we were able to move forward together as one, as you would desire us to do. So God, we're so grateful now for all you're doing in our lives, God. And as we go through this retreat, God, we ask that you continue to give us guidance and show us what it is that we need to change or keep the same. Because God, we know that with you, all things are possible. So we thank you now, God, for all that you have already done. We thank you for what you're going to do. God, we love you and we adore you. And we thank you in advance for helping us to move forward and looking forward to what tomorrow we hold, may hold. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And we are, it is suggested in the guide that we list things, first of all, that I need to work on.
We're going to jump forward.
In his little garden area, or whether he's working to put together something in the house for me, or just being on his job, and he's a perfectionist. He does things unto perfection, and I love that. He's very devoted, whether it's to family, friends, his job, his health, my well-being. He's very, very devoted. And that's one thing that really like stands out for me, is that he does not just do anything half-heartedly. He puts his heart and soul into everything that he does, no matter how tedious or how big a project it may be. He gives it his all. And I just think that's the way to be. And lastly, I love that he's a family man, from to our children, to our family, whether it's his brothers or sisters, or my brothers or sisters, our nieces and nephews, regardless as to what side of the family that they're on. If there's something going on and he can be of help, he can be of assistance, he goes right in. He doesn't think twice. He doesn't do anything with an attitude. And he's just always like really happy. And because he's so happy, it makes me happy. So those are the things that I really do love about him.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
And these are the things that I really love about Jeanette. First of all, I love your supportive behavior. There's a lot of times I know this is not an area where you want to go down or something that you want to do, but because it's someplace I'm going, you're right there with me and you give me your all in all in the things that we do. And I love doing things together as a union, as a family. And I love the support that you give in that. So first of all, thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Your supportive behavior. The way you serve me as unto God, I mean, from eating to clothing to daily activities. When I was sick, you nursed me, washed me, bathed me, fed me. When I couldn't even feed myself, when it comes time on a regular basis of our daily care, you're up there making sure I have meals to eat, clothes to wear, pressed and ironed. I never go anywhere looking shabby because you just won't permit it to be so. but that really is a great help and an assistance. You know, and yes, there's a lot of those things I could do myself. I acted, but you willingly continue to do those things far above and beyond the necessity of them being done because I'm ill or I'm sick or incapable of doing them. So I do really appreciate that also. You're never underappreciated for the things that you do, most especially the cleaning and personal hygiene, not only for yourself, but also for me. You make sure I stay clean regardless whether I want to or not. You make sure you stay clean. You keep the household spotless and impeccable. You know, now I'm the type of guy, I may get up out the bed and I'll throw the covers across the bed and put the pillows up and fluff them up, and that's my idea of making up a bed. But you just make sure you change the sheets regularly, put the blankets in, fold it like it's military style with the hospital style with the corners, pillows puffed up and set dress right dress. You make sure everything is in its place and in its order, and that is your excellence in service. You know, the way that you keep the household together and running, and that's an area that you really take care of well, and I don't even have to concern myself with because I know it's done. And this is not because I'm making you do it, but it's because of something that you love doing. And so I thank you for it. And then there's nothing I can have but gratitude for the things that you do, because that's a help to me. It's something that's being done that I'm really responsible for making sure it's done. Now, let's not get it twisted. At the end of the day and at the end of all eternity, the man that God placed in the marriage is the one that's responsible for all of these duties, the cooking, the cleaning. I know men don't want to hear it, but that's the bare facts to it. But when you have a mate that helps you and takes those responsibilities and does them well, where you don't have to go back and double check, but you know it's being done, then that is a great help. And so that's why I keep saying thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So not only your cleaning and personal hygiene and the way that you serve and daily activities, but your smile and your eyes. You know, it's that kind of when you walk in, regardless what's going on or how bad the day may be going, it lights me up with joy. And even in the worst of days, it's like that stuff don't even matter no more. You give me a purpose and a drive to want to keep on going forward and to do better. Your conversation and behavior, always thinking you can get along with everybody. And I love that, even though I don't agree with it, I love it about you because it just gives so much positive hope that people still believe that you can solve every situation and get along with people peacefully. And that's what we're supposed to strive to do. And so that gives me purpose again through her to do those things or to try to do those things, even if it's something that I don't believe that can happen.
We're going to pause there and come back later for about another 10 minutes of the marriage and family vision, phase one and phase two. Phase one, we just heard, was starting off together. For tonight, we're going to open up with our Bible challenge. What is real fellowship with God? And I turn it over to Missionary Elder Jeanette Johnson for that portion.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you guys can hear me. What is real fellowship with God? Psalm 133, verse 1 says, how wonderful it is, how pleasant for God's people to live together in harmony. wants us to experience life together. As per the Bible, it is called a fellowship. When you experience fellowship, size doesn't matter. When you have real fellowship, it is not just about showing up, but it is also about sharing, serving, and giving. Sharing is experience of individuals. Serving is God and others, and giving is not just about finances, but also about our time and compassion when it's needed. Think about this. Jesus only had 12 disciples, knowing that he could have had more. Having a small group gives everyone a chance to participate, as you can see with our group. When we look at the body of Christ, it is just like your own body. It contains many small cells. Matthew 18:20 says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." This is the promise from God about small groups. Now, please know that God is in the midst of any size group of believers. It doesn't matter whether it's 2 or 5,000. My experience with large groups like that, it's not as personal for me. That's the experience that I've had. I don't know if anyone else has had that experience, but when you're in larger churches, sometimes, yeah, they know you by your tithe giving. They know you if you sing in the choir. They know you if you're on the usher board, if you come to Bible study, if you come to Sunday school. But if you don't do any of these things, it's very possible that they don't know you. So one thing that I do know is that in any group, we must not be superficial. Our fellowship must be as authentic as our design of persons and our love for him. Real fellowship allows us to share our pain, confess failures, disclose doubt, acknowledge our weaknesses, and ask for help and prayer. Unfortunately, in some churches or spiritual groups, you may find the opposite. That the atmosphere may be full of role-playing and false politeness. People may wear masks. And I'm not talking about the mask we are currently wearing due to COVID. I'm talking about the mask of pretense and keeping up their guard. These types of attitudes are the death of real fellowship. When we become open with our lives, we can experience real fellowship. 1 John 1:7 says, "But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin." Intimacy does not occur in darkness. Darkness is where we hide our fears, our failures, and flaws. In the light, we bring them all out in the open and can admit who we really are. And this is what makes us authentic. Being authentic makes us courageous and it makes us humble. This allows us to grow spiritually and be emotionally healthy. Have you ever just been in a situation where you had something really, really going on in your life and you just kind of felt kind of embarrassed or uncomfortable, but then you actually shared it with one of your spiritual brothers or sisters, and they were able to really like give you really good advice and kind of help you to understand, hey, listen, you know, made a mistake, you know, it happened, and, you know, let's just, you know, pray about it. And it's going to be okay. And you just feel like that burden has been lifted off of your shoulders. Do you know that every time you understand and affirm someone's feelings, you're building a relationship. Now, there are different levels of fellowship, and each of them are appropriate at different times. The simplest is the fellowship of sharing. We share experiences, likes and dislikes to know more about one another. The fellowship of serving can be serving one another, serving in a ministry, or serving God. The most intense of fellowshipping is suffering. When we share someone's heartache and grief and burdens, it's the time when we need each other the most. Galatians 6:2 says, "Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." I don't know about you, but I know that when I've had brothers and sisters in Christ and they were going through grieving periods or periods of they had something traumatic to occur in their life. And when you really care about a person, you allow them to lean on you for strength and encouragement. And you're doing what we need to do as brothers and sisters in Christ and being in the body of Christ is that when my brother hurts, my sister hurts, I hurt. We can grieve together. We can show one another that, you know, sister, brother, I got your back. I'm there for you. You know, I'm just a phone call away. Now, sometimes people will tell you I'm a phone call away, but they're calling at 11:30, 12 o'clock at night and see if they answer the phone.
Amen.
But I do know that there is a God, no matter what time of the day, the night, no matter what's going on, he's there. He listens. He is our comforter in a time of struggle, in a time of grieving and fear. You know, and sometimes when we're fearful of things, sometimes fear comes at night. And again, you gonna call your brothers at 12 o'clock at night and see if they gonna answer the phone. Well, you may have some that may, but then you also may have some that may not. We need friends to have faith in God for us and to pull us through. In the body of Christ, people should be real and tangible, even when God seems distant. Because sometimes you can be in that prayer mode and just feel like, for whatever reason, like you're not feeling that connection with God. You don't feel that closeness with God. But sometimes when you have that prayer partner or that friend that you can lean on and say, hey, sister, you know, I just need you to pray with me. I need you to be in agreement with what I'm going through. And sometimes it's not, you know, when we think agreement, we have to be on one accord. And we really should be. And sometimes a person could be praying for something that you may not feel that, yeah, well, I don't know if that's what you really want. But if I am your friend, your brother, your sister in Christ, then as long as I know it's not something that is going to hurt you or harm you, I'm going to be in agreement with you. Because I believe that God will give us the desires of our heart at the right time. And sometimes, you know, we could be praying for things. I remember I used to say this prayer before my son was going to college. And, I, you know, pretty much I had a good job. His dad had a good job. But when you think about college, anytime you can put, anytime a child can go to college and you don't have to pay for it, you know that's a blessing. So I used to always pray this prayer every single day about my son going to college and that the Lord was going to open every door that needed to be opened so that he would have the opportunity that God could give to him. And 4 years later, it came time for him to go to college. Did not God answer every prayer? When I tell you, even before my son went to college, tell me, you have a child living in an urban area, and he's going to basketball camps by some of the greatest basketball players, Michael Jordan, Stephen Pippen, and these are old-time players, but back, we're talking some years back, my son went to basketball camps week after week, summer after summer. I never paid a dime. He worked and was trained under the best. That's God, God's favor. So when we pray and we just continue to, I'm not going to cease. That's why it really pays to pray without ceasing. No matter what it looks like, continue praying. When we need friends to have faith in God for us and to pull us through. In the body of Christ, people should be real and tangible even when God seems distant. When Job was suffering, this is what he needed. God gives us all the directions we need on how to live. This scripture that says a despairing man should have the kindness of his friend, even if he forsakes the fear of the Almighty. Job 6:14. This scripture is giving us direction. It's letting us know a friend sticks closer than a brother. Fellowship is also a place of where we can experience mercy. It is a place of grace where mistakes aren't rubbed in, but rubbed out. Fellowship happens when mercy wins over justice. Isn't justice something all of us should be entitled to? We all stumble and fall short of, but guess what? God gives us mercy and he gives us grace. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Mercy should be offered to each other and willing receive from each other. So if I'm giving you mercy and grace, what's wrong with you giving me mercy and grace back? Nothing, absolutely nothing. And this is where our fellowship with forgiveness. You can't have fellowship without forgiveness. God wants us that we should never hold grudges. It took me some time to learn this, but as I have grown in Christ, I have a better understanding of the importance of forgiveness. Colossians 3:13 says, make allowance for each other's faults. Forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. And see, sometimes we have a tendency to take God's word and use it when we want to use it. But God's word doesn't change. It stays the same. If we are children of God, we're part of the body of Christ, we have got to learn and realize that his commandments are the same all the time, no matter what the situation. His commandment is his commandment. His direction is his direction. And we should keep in mind in every situation, no matter what we do, no matter whether it's with our children, our parents, our friends, our cousins, whoever it may be, we must learn to utilize God's word all the time. I've learned that God's word will keep you out of trouble. It will keep you saved. and it will keep you praying. Because some of the things that God asks us to do is difficult. But after a while, you get to a place of, I want to do right because I don't want to suffer the consequences.
Amen.
Consequences are always there in wrongdoing, no matter what it is, no matter whether it's forgiveness or loving someone or just doing the right thing. So God's word, if we're going to live by his word, we have to obey his word. It's a part of his commandment. It doesn't mean that we get to pick and choose when to forgive. It doesn't mean that we really should pick and choose when to do right or when to do wrong. If we can help it, we should never do wrong. But we're human. We're flesh. We're not perfect. We're not going to always get it right. But thank God that we can repent. Many people are reluctant to show mercy because they don't understand the difference between trust and forgiveness. Forgiveness is letting go of the past, and trust has to do with your future behavior. Whenever you're hurt by someone, you have a choice to make. Will I use my energy and emotions for retaliation or for resolution? But guess what? You can't do both. So, fellowshipping with God, it has to be real. We serve a real God. What would your life be like if God was not authentic? What would your life be like if God chose when he was going to forgive you or when he was going to answer your prayer? How do you think your life would be? I know for me, I want to have a real relationship with God. And because I want to have a real relationship with God, I have chosen to live by his word. Again, I'm not perfect, and neither are you. None of us are perfect. But your life can be so much better, so much easier, if we just learn to walk by his word, live by his word, because we're believers of Christ. Amen? So, remember, I need others in my life to experience God's fellowship. You cannot have a fellowship with God without others. So I leave you with this one question. What step can I take to connect with another person at a more genuine, heart-to-heart level? Think about that. Heart-to-heart. Not in my feelings. Not I'm just going to do it because. I'm going to do it because I love God. God bless you.
Amen. That was lovely. I enjoyed that. That really had some good meat on the bones there. Anyone have any comments, questions, concerns? Somebody tell me, what did you get out of the lesson? I got some good notes. What stuck to you? Experiencing life together and fellowship. I'm going to show you my list. Now, I didn't look at her list before I made my list. I made my list, and then I'm listening to the Bible study, but this is how closely our lists work together. Acts 2 and 42 through 44, we're together and have all things common is what fellowship looks like when you're walking together with somebody. 1 Corinthians 1:9, called into the fellowship of his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. 2 Corinthians 8:4, take upon us the fellowship of the ministry to the others or to the crowd or to the saints of God. Galatians 2:9, the right hand of fellowship. Anybody remember that term? You ever been in a Baptist church and when you joined the church, the first thing they wanted to do was give you that right hand of fellowship. Amen. And that right hand of fellowship is a biblical term. A biblical term. That's how the disciples greeted Paul and his fellow laborers coming back from Asia. They greeted them with the right hand of fellowship to let them know that they are welcome in their house of God. How about the fellowship of the mystery? What is the mystery of God? What is that mystery of God? That mystery is grace and mercy, because nobody can fully quite understand it or fully comprehend what it took for us to have grace, the unmerited favor of God, the mystery of God in faith, having faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord. How about the fellowship in the gospel? I don't know about you, but I could be anywhere doing anything. And as soon as I hear somebody mention the name of Jesus, suddenly my ears perk up and I get excited because they're talking about my Lord, my Savior, my brother, and my King. All of them, and my friend, most of all. Amen. How about the fellowship in the gospel, where we're all united because of salvation's sake? We all have a fellowship in the gospel. How about the fellowship, Philippians 2:1, the fellowship of the Spirit, as she was speaking about even in the word that she gave us this evening, the fellowship of the Spirit. Amen. Because that Spirit, that there's a word called koinonia. It's the fellowship that goes from heart to heart and breast to breast, that common fellowship that we have together where we love one another and we can fellowship and have a good time in the common grounds and understanding because we are of one accord in our thinking and our behavior. The fellowship of the Spirit, that's what unites us. And how about this one, the one that sometimes people really don't understand as Christians, and they think that everything is going to be highly high and la-di-da, the fellowship of his suffering. Don't you know God has so much faith in you, he counts you just like Job, that he would even tell Satan, have you considered my good saint Chloe, or my good saint Deanne, or my good saint Shari? They're so faithful, no matter what you do to them, you cannot make them turn on me and curse me. They will be faithful to the very end. My good servant Jeanette, or my good servant Elder Clyburn, he is faithful and will not turn on me, regardless what you do to him or what may come. Even if you put sickness in his body, even if you imprison him, even if you cast him out and leave him homeless for years at a time, he still will not forsake me or curse my name. Huh? Oh, yeah, I'm going to just listen. And then that last one, we have fellowship. And most of all, because this flesh longs and cleaves, and it doesn't have to be for romantic intimacy, but just for the simple fellowship, one with another, somebody that we can have common ground with. Forgiveness is the past. Yes, it is. Forgiveness is the past. Repentance is the future. So remember all of those things about fellowship. And we're so grateful this evening for our Facebook Live people. We thank you for hanging in there with us. You counted it not robbery to be with us, to have fellowship and Bible study and Bible challenge with us on what is real fellowship with God. And we're going to pray you out this evening. We're so thankful, dear God. And God, Lord, we thank you for them, everyone under the sounds of our voice, dear God. We pray something that has been done or something that they've heard this evening, dear Lord, that they might come crying unto you, what must I do to be saved? I want to be a part of this. I want to be like this description of things that they're talking about. And then, dear Father, we pray and ask that you would have an answer for them, that they would come to Romans 10:9-10, that if they should confess with their mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in their heart that God has raised from the dead, that they will know, as your word says, that thou shalt be saved. We're grateful for them, dear Lord. We ask and pray your anointing upon them, especially the mothers this evening, wherever they may be, dear Lord. A special blessing on their day, dear God. Keep them safe in your arms, under the shadow of your wings. Keep them as the apple of them eye, dear God. And let them see you as the strong tower that the righteous can run into, and they will be saved. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God for you, Facebook, and have a good evening. Amen. And that. And we're going to continue with anyone else have any comments, concerns, questions, anything this evening? Okay. We're going to give you not that one. Where did it go now? Nope. Nope. There it is. We're going to give you the last 10 minutes of what we had this evening, 24. There you go, 25 of our marriage and family vision.
He didn't make us to be lone creatures. He put us together to learn and to agree with each other. He put us together to strengthen each other. He put us together to lift up one another. He put us together to represent his will on earth. And he put us together to defeat loneliness. Thirdly, when hard times come, how will our understanding of the purpose above impact our relationship? When they say the purpose above, it's when hard times come, how will our understanding of why God put us together impact our relationship?
Well, first we have to believe and remember that hard times are going to come.
Amen.
And hard times can be, excuse me.
That's all right.
Okay. Hard times can be financial. They can be situations that occur within our family. Our children. I mean, you just never know. But one of the things that we need to keep in mind is first we need to remember why God put us together.
Amen.
And when these situations arise, that we need to be able to first seek God and, you know, go into the scriptures to help us to get through whatever the situation may be. And we need to remember what makes us victorious.
Yes.
So when we think about those things, that will help us through the hard times.
Cover the core values of dreams, values, and beliefs.
Well, so walk in agreement. We do want to walk in a successful direction. So when we look at dreams, for both of us, our children live out of state. We live in Virginia, and we have children that live in North Carolina and California. So we would definitely want, our dream is to live closer to our children and our grandchildren, and for them to be saved, for them to really know, to live with God being the head of their lives, as we do. When I look at values, when we look at values, our values, we value the relationship that we have with God.
Amen.
The relationship that we have with each other, our family and friends, and the peace that we have in our living environment. One of the things that is very important to us is to have peace in our household. It's nothing worse than to be in an environment with your companion and you don't get along. You're always combating, you're always at one another's throat. But I thank God that there's a lot of peace in our home.
Yes.
And please don't misinterpret that we don't have disagreements, but we have learned how to have our disagreements and how to handle them in a way that remains respectful to one another, and that there is a peace of, even when we're not on the same page, there still is a peace because we're not verbally abusing one another. We still can find that moment in peace that let's sit down and talk about it.
Yes.
And, you know, it's you know, moving forward, you want to encourage them and, hey, listen, you know what? Yeah. And, you know, it happened and it should not have happened. I always try to be sure that they can examine themselves into what part did I play in that situation?
Yes, yes.
And what could I have done differently? And once you know that, it's okay, now what do we need to do to fix it? Let's just go with giving the advice that is needed so that they can move forward. Because, you know, everybody is going to make mistakes. Some are worse than others. Sometimes things happen. You don't think before you react. Things happen. But as parents, I don't care how old your children are, they're still your children. You're going to love them. They're going to make mistakes. Be there for them and let them know, first and foremost, I love you. And how can we fix it? How soon can we fix it so that you can move on with your life?
Amen. That sounds absolutely wonderful. We have concluded sections or phases 1 and 2 of establishing our yearly vision for our marriage and family, or family and marriage. And in section 1, we went over where we are. We made an agreement to allow God to move us forward in our family and our marriage. And in section 2, we actually looked at our family and examined, or our marriage and our family, and examined some of the issues, some of the things that we feel, if there were changes that needed made, what they could be. In phase 3, we'll be looking at our marriage, the spiritual life of our marriage, and we'll be providing visions and goals that we want for our marriage moving forward. And finally, in phase 4, we'll be creating a mission statement for this year for our family moving forward, and we'll be writing a summary for these 2 phases of family and marriage in establishing a yearly vision. So please stay tuned, come back and join us. We'll be picking up with our marriage, the vision that we have for our marriage and the goals and expectations for it. Thank you for attending. Please stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Amen. Huh? So let's turn to our next week assignment. I did the assignment this week so that you all can see what to expect for next week. First part of the assignment was that we were going to do the journaling 23-40. You all are already familiar with that. But in your SWOT analysis, what are your strengths and your weaknesses? I listed my strengths as 1, education, having wisdom and knowledge. Some wisdom and knowledge, I should say, because it's something that we still seek after. You don't always get it right. You think one thing and it turns out to be another thing. But being educated, having enough education to learn how to look at things and use your analytical mind where you can see the outcome when we look at them. Leadership ability, emotional stamina, confidence in God, humility before God, willingness to listen and hear. Even though my wife would probably differ with me on that way, she has a very keen and focused voice in my ear at all times. She just doesn't realize it. Obedience to act. When I feel the unction of the Holy Spirit saying move, I've got to the point now where I just want to move in that direction he's leading me just to see what's there, because I've learned that it usually works out for my benefit. When he says save, or when he says hold on, or when he says not yet. I've learned to listen because it usually works out for my benefit. I've even learned to listen to my wife, even though she would probably say that I don't, because I found out that her feelings have very significant meaning in our destiny. I think it, but when she feels it, she's usually right. I don't understand how it works. I've just learned to lean on that because she usually has the best outcome with her feelings than I do with my pre-planning and thinking. But we've learned to work jointly together with them both. What are my weaknesses? Procrastination. I still get wait sometimes to the last minute to start something when I could have already gotten it done already. Lack of consistency, being able to schedule a day and then stick to the schedule that you plan, where you have time for things to do and you do things at their proper time. Now, I understand that the Holy Spirit is really the leader and the guide, and he can alter the agenda, but still you should be able to stick to the agenda until the Holy Spirit alters it. Prioritizing. Sometimes I get things out of priority. Something will catch my eye or my attention, and I get to running with it, and I forget that I'm supposed to be doing something over here to the left while I'm doing something to the right. Prayer and study. I think that even though I know a lot, I think that I should be more consistent in prayer and study. And scripture memorization. My brain just isn't what it used to be. It doesn't hold on to things like it used to. So I need to put a little bit more time and effort into scripture memorization. So when I ask you what your strengths and your weaknesses are, I'm talking about overall. I'm talking about your strengths as part of life experience. And I'm talking about your strengths as part of your spiritual experience, your relationship with God. What are your strengths and what are your weaknesses? There's a philosopher that once said, made a statement that has stood through the generations of time for thousands and thousands of years. To thine own self be true. And if you don't know yourself, then you're in an awful predicament. So this exercise is just for you to be able to identify yourself. Amen. Amen. So we'll be looking forward to going over that with you all next week. Anyone else have anything they'd like to share this evening before we close out? We're down to our last maybe 7 or 8 minutes. Any burning desires, any testimonies? Has God done anything significantly good for you this week?
Yes, he's done great things for me.
Oh, amen. Share.
So, your clip was beautiful. I just need you guys to know that.
Say again. I'm sorry, ma'am.
The clip that you showed us?
Yes.
It was really, really nice.
Well, I'm so glad you enjoyed that, Michelle.
And of course, I always have a testimony.
Amen. Go right ahead. We're really heartily listening.
Oh, I was just, yeah. It's a great week.
A great, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
You said you had a great week?
Hello? Sorry. My phone keeps going on mute. Oh, so okay. Yes, I did say I had a great week, but I do have a testimony.
Go ahead.
So I always say when you give to others, it always comes back and you may not see it right away. So this is actually different because it's a kind of touching situation for me. But I was driving one day, and I'm sorry, I'm just walking away from the kids. I was driving one day, and I don't know, I just got hit with some of my car and totaled it. So now I'm like paying attention to everything around me instead of paying.
Your phone just went out, Shari. Your phone is going in and out. You can't make out anything.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Okay, so what was the last thing you heard?
You were driving.
Okay, so somebody just totaled my car. I don't know if you guys knew about it, but somebody ran a stop sign and she hit my car and totaled it. I literally just got finished making payments on my car. I was on my way to pick up my title. So now I'm so terrified of somebody hitting me that I'm paying attention to everything around me instead of what's in front of me. And I was driving home one day from work and I hit somebody, an actual person. And of course, my thought process was her just taking care of her and making sure she was okay. And luckily, she didn't have any broken bones or anything like that. You know, she was just like, thank you so much for staying, because in this area, I would picture somebody just running away from me, and you stay with me, you care for me, everything else. She was like, I'm not ruining your life. Like, it's not that serious. Like, I'm just grateful that it didn't turn out worse than it was. Amen. So that's definitely my testimony.
Amen. That's a beautiful testimony. Because you know,
it can be a lot worse than.
Yeah.
It could have been a lot worse than what it was. I mean, when my two sisters got hit at the same time. And my sister to this day, she hit the car accident was 2018. To this day, she's still suffering from that car accident. And the young lady that hit her was young. She had bullcrap insurance. And she could have cared less. She was so busy talking about them being in the street. Well, if you try to cross the street, where the devil am I supposed to be?
So, they had the signal to cross at the crosswalk, and she tried to run through the crosswalk before anybody could get across, and she ended up hitting.
And she hit. And my sister to this day is still suffering, and it took me a while, especially after I found out about her the child's insurance and the lawyers that my sister and my niece got. Basically, they were just like, well, you know what, you know, you're really not going to get anything. She, you know, didn't have really good insurance or whatever. All they cared about was daggone money.
Money, yeah.
And I believe that if my sister had pursued it, she could have gotten something from the deal. Not that you're looking for anything. It's just that, unfortunately, you know, when people do stuff, take responsibility for your actions. You know, right, wrong, or indifferent. Take responsibility for your action. And Sharvey, I commend you that you did take responsibility. You made sure that the person was good. That whole situation. So, I'm grateful to God for your compassion and.
We actually turned out to be friends because I think she was like really going through a lot that day. And when I had stopped to make sure she was okay, she just kept saying like, it's just been a rough day for me. She said she had just buried somebody and then she was trying to rush to the airport to get her father. So I was like, well, you know, just relax. I didn't want her to drive off with her being crying and upset. And stuff like that. And then now she texts me every day, just even though she's the one that got hit, she's like, are you okay? How are you doing with sleeping and things like that? Because this is a traumatic experience for you. And it's just like, God brought us together for a reason. And she just seemed like she needed that friend that day. And I sat with her for about an hour to make sure she was good. And I was like, you know, you can call a cop, so I got insurance, whatever you wanna do. I just wanna make sure you're okay. And she was like, no, I don't wanna do any of that. I texted her and made sure she was okay when she went to the hospital. She called, she informed me of everything that happened. She said, the cops did come up here. I told them we already have an agreement. She said, you had scrubs on. God forbid I mess up your nurse's license and it's not that deep. She said, I got a couple of bruises, I'm not broken.
Bless the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
And it just made me pay attention more to when I'm driving instead of being so scared, because again, I'm paying attention to everything else around me, scared that somebody else is going to hit me because of what I just went through with my other car. And I had my kids with me. It was just a terrifying situation. Now it's like a freaking person, Sherry, seriously.
Glad for the outcome.
Thank God.
Amen.
Everybody.
The outcome is very good.
Yes. But you know, I keep seeing your ladder will be greater. But I had a phenomenal week because it was my birthday.
Birthday.
I thank God for my family, for my husband, who always makes sure that I am happy. And he doesn't cut any corners. Anything that I say I would like, it's pretty much mine for the asking. It's almost like, okay, Lord, I want this, and it's there. So it's been, honestly, these last 2 weeks, us going away on our excursion, our vision retreat, and then celebrating my birthday and Mother's Day. And yes, I did get gifts for all three. Not only did I get gifts, but I was treated like royalty. I don't think we have eaten out this much since COVID. But we celebrated, and I'm grateful. And it's not just, you know, the gifts and everything, but it's just like the pouring out of love that I received. So many birthday shout outs. Deanne sent me the most beautiful card, and I'm laughing because she pointed out in the card, like, she emphasized certain things that she felt important to her, that the type of person that I am, which it was really great. It was a beautiful card. So Deanne, thank you so much. I love that card. And it was a surprise. So, you know, just to have that outpouring of love. You know, sometimes people just don't get. And I've really felt that over the last couple of weeks with the different shout outs for our anniversary, birthday, and then Mother's Day. So I just know I'm blessed.
Amen. That you are.
I told you I'm in the wrong household.
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
I'm glad you enjoyed your birthday and Mother's Day as well. You deserve it.
I'm glad. And you know, when you have a mate that takes the time to do all the things that she does and make sure that she does them well, you want to celebrate them. It makes you want to celebrate them and do something specific and unique and special just for them.
Yeah.
Maybe you need to
show it
on yours. I don't know if they can see you.
Your camera works just like mine, I think.
Shut up, nigga.
Yeah. Is that the birthstone?
Yeah.
Oh, you can see him? Am I showing him?
I just see the box. No, you need to turn it around. And I think, Miss Jeanette, you're better off showing it because you're closer than Elder Jeffery.
Let's see what you see. Oh, okay.
No, you're in the wrong camera. There you go.
That's her birthstone.
Oh, that is beautiful.
Emerald with diamond dust around it, with diamond pieces around it.
Oh, my God. Okay, Miss Jeanette.
She got the matching earrings to go with it.
That is cute.
I had told him, I was like, I haven't had my birthstone since I was a little kid. So when we were in Pennsylvania, we walked in the store and they just had all this jewelry with birthstones and everything. And I was like, well, just go over here and look. I was like, these are cute. And I was like, anything over here is cute. And I walked away. And
full behind.
Came out the store.
That she is.
Yeah,
it sounds like she's spoiled. Talking about from I want that and walk away. Okay.
But I was like, you know, anything over here will be fine. And I know that I am truly blessed. Thank you. And when they say your ladder will be greater, my ladder is greater. And it's not just about the gift. It's just when you know that you're loved, and it's shown in every area of our marriage. So that just makes me, it just makes life sweet.
Amen.
Yeah, I had went to Jersey City today. I think I told you I was going to Jersey City today, and I met with my friend's aunt, and she lost her mother. I don't know how long ago, but she doesn't have a mother. Can you hear me? I'm sorry.
Uh-huh. We hear you.
Okay. So she doesn't have a mother, and she wanted to go to her mother's gravesite, but she couldn't. She lives in Jersey City, and her mother's gravesite is in Somerset, but because it rained, it was too wet for her to go, so she was going to spend Mother's Day by herself. So me and my friend went out there, and we spent Mother's Day with her. We got her a gift, and then she was like, oh, she had to go to the grocery store for the week. And I just felt so good about myself because I bought her groceries and whatever she needed. And when we got back to the house, she gave me this biggest hug. And she was just like, thank you so much. You truly made my Mother's Day. And it's just the smaller things matter. You know what I mean? It's just a simple word or a simple quality time that matters to somebody. You never know what the next person is going through. And as much as I say that I'm stressing or I got this going on, I know that it can be a lot worse.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And, I was going to say this, Chloe and Sharvey, you both still have your mom. Deanne, myself, Jeff, our moms have been gone for a period of time. I lost my mother. My mom was 58 when she died on her birthday. She had a massive heart attack.
Hey, babe, do me a favor.
What?
Who closed that prayer for those who want a long conference?
If anybody wants to log off, just let me know, because we can close out in prayer. And then anybody that wants to stay on, that's fine.
Amen.
Just send me a thing in the chat letting me know if anybody needs to leave. But I lost my mom early. And so for those of you that still have your mom, please, I implore you, no matter what your situation may be with your mom, you only get one.
Amen.
And I know sometimes I didn't always see eye to eye with my mom, but she was my mom and I loved her dearly. And now that she's not here, it is hard sometimes. There's situations, that I just kind of feel like, oh my God, like I wish my mom was here. Like, what would she think about this? And what would she think about that?
Mm-hmm.
So, Mother's Day can be a little difficult, especially if you had like a good relationship with your mom. It can be hard because moms are usually like the backbone to the family. Like they keep everything going, and it's mom,
Amen.
So, It can be hard, but I thank God, like, I miss my mom, but at the same time, I thank God that my memories are great memories that make me smile. And I've learned to live with the fact that she's not here. And that can be hard. It can be challenging, and everybody deals with things differently. We're individuals, so, everybody doesn't deal with things the same way, and that's okay. But coming to the end of this day, it's just great to be able to take the day and just to remember the mom that you have, the mom that you had, and think about the memories and the good and the bad. And sometimes the bad does outweigh the good.
So, you know, you have to kind of try to separate and be able to say, you know what, it's mom. And even though this may not look good over here, but over there, she's this or she's that. So try to pull out the greatness
that's
of
right.
your mom.
That's right.
Because one day, you know, they're not going to be here. And you're going to look back on those times and just, you know, you think about certain things. So, you know, relationships, we love with our heart. And you know, it is great to have loved ones that you can love on and be close to and all of those things. And I'm gonna be real, for a long time I wasn't close to my family, so I leaned on friends and they became my family. So sometimes you have friends that may take the place per se of your family because
yes.
of circumstances and situations or whatever, but always remember and keep in mind the God that we serve. And God wants us to have the best. He because it's what his promises say to us. It's what we know about God, that he is a loving God. And even though sometimes you don't get that same love or that same treatment, we still have a responsibility to love anyway.
Yes, Lord.
And Jeff has a thing sometimes. when I make him mad, and he says to somebody, yeah, I just have to love her anyway.
He ain't supposed to tell everything.
So, and I'm just kind of like, okay, well, God love me anyway.
Amen.
And you know, sometimes you look at situations and truth be told, you look at something and you just say, you know what, it's not that serious. It's really not. Like, get over it, girl. It'll be all right. And sometimes, and don't get me wrong, because just because I said that for me, get over it, it's going to be okay. I don't mean that for you guys, because everybody is different in how they deal with and accept things. And I am just that person that certain things I will just be like, all right, stop it. You seriously, it's not that serious, Jeanette, stop. You making a mountain out of a molehill.
Okay.
It's not.
I'm sorry.
It's going to be okay. And, you know, you have to pull through your strengths and know who you are as a person. Love on yourself. And sometimes God puts us in places for reasons. I remember there was a time before I married Jeff, and I was in a lonely place for a while. But during that lonely time, what I thought was lonely to a point, God started speaking. He started really speaking to my spirit and showing me certain things. And I was just like, I got so in awe of God until I forgot about I was alone. And then I really, Sharpie said, can she close out with this one that started?
Yes, what does she want to close out with? Tell her, go ahead and sing.
Sorry, go ahead. I'm not singing, but go ahead. Keep talking, Miss Jeanette.
And
what story does she want to, what song does she want to close out
I'll
with?
Find out.
Oh, okay.
So I learned during that time, I really wound it up. Go get it, Mary.
Gotcha. Hold on.
I learned during that time to really just dig into to my relationship with God, and God gave me an opportunity to find out some things about myself, some things that I needed to work on personally for me. And at first I was just like, why am I doing all of this? And it wasn't until after I got married that I realized God was preparing me for my husband. And that is what helped to make our relationship stronger and better, because I had an opportunity to start looking at me and realize that, girl, you ain't all that you need to be. So So God helped me with that. He prepared me with that. And I don't know what God is preparing any of us for. I do know that if, you know, having that relationship with God, hear his voice, hear from him, and let him be your guide. And understand that God, he sees every tear that you shed, every hurt, every pain. He's never going to leave us comfortless. So even when you think you're not being comforted, open your heart to let God embrace him and let him be your comforter. Let him give you the strength that you need and keep it. Get yourself into a mode of, I am going to encourage myself no matter what. I'm just going to keep moving forward. I'm going to keep trusting God because I know he has a plan for me, and I'm just going to wait on him. And he does answer. And always remember, you have us. Yeah. So, you know, you're struggling. You don't know which way to turn. You can't figure it out. Hey, if we can't help you, we know somebody that can. Mm-hmm. Our door is always open. Our phone is always open. Our ears are always open. And most of all, our hearts are open.
Amen. Ain't that the truth? I'm downloading. Go get it, Mary. Mary.
Go get that blessing.
Elder is downloading.
Oh, you ready for it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Have a nice week, everyone.
You all as well. Go ahead and pray yourself. Well.
Just know that God loves you, and so do we.
Can't go but so loud because it keeps on clicking on. I like that. Your blessing. It's your time.
You've been qualified. His mercy multiplied. You cannot be denied. Cause you're fully certified. It's official. Go ahead and testify. He's gonna bless you. You're gonna bless him. Now God be glorified. When God goes time. It's your time.
You're listening to the sound.
Thank you.
Christ is my firm
foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. Oh, so why would he fail me now? He won't.
My testimony.
my
You all have a great night and a good evening. See you next week. God bless you.